Hello, everyone who is online now and will watch later. I'm so excited to be a part of this event. And I'm happy for you all to be joining us today. This is the second event in the new Wattpad Speak series. This one aptly titled Catharsis Through Creativity. Throughout this event, I'll probably mispronounce catharsis, but that's okay. That's not the purpose of the event. I am super excited to see that you all are here and able to join us, as I know our panelists are as well. So let's begin. I'm I-Yana Tucker. I'm the senior manager on the Wattpad Studios team, and I personally get to work with some of the most influential authors on the Wattpad platform, and I am delighted to moderate this panel with a few of the amazing influencers that we have today. This event is part of the 2020 year in review for Wattpad, and it highlights the year's most important storytelling moments on Wattpad. We're going to be talking a bit about some tough topics today, but of course we want to make sure that this is a safe space for engaging conversation. So feel free to ask your questions, have your insights at the end of the half hour, and we'll get to them. So let me jump into kind of where we're starting off. The reality of 2020 was that it was fraught with tragedy, cultural and generational divisions, and honestly, not to mention uncertainty that was felt on a global scale. Today's intimate and unfiltered conversation is meant to be an exploration of all the ways that these important conversations have influenced what people are reading and why people are writing. From COVID-19 to the political outcry against racism, police brutality, and even the policing of female bodies, both on and offline. Readers and writers on Wattpad sought catharsis through creativity, turning to stories to support social justice and create a community in a year of quarantine. For example, though pandemics and dystopian narratives have always been popular on Wattpad, this year there was a significant surge in those stories. Some tagged pandemic, that was increased by 2,104%. So are Wattpadders finding more comfort in fiction when reality is so uncertain? Or is there a need to have a focus and levity when there is so much chaos? Well, today we're going to explore some of these questions and potentially leave you with some more information, feeling more connected, and hopefully a bit more hopeful. And I can't say this enough, there is no better group to have this conversation. So let's get started. First, a little housekeeping. The first 30 minutes, I'll have some questions and discussion topics for Beth, Daven, and Natalie. And then the latter half of the hour, the audience questions, we will answer them. If you do have any questions for any of our authors, please feel free to drop them in the Q&A chat box on the right side of your screen, and we'll answer as many of them as we possibly can in this discussion. And I know that there will be quite a bit. So let's dive in. I want to start by introducing our panelists. First up, we have Daven McQueen. She is the debut author of The Invincible Summer of Juniper Jones, and that was published earlier this year on June 16th, 2020. Boston Globe has quoted saying, McQueen deftly balances the rollicking summer adventures of Ethan and Juniper. With the gravity of racial discrimination, the book provides a nuanced look at its characters' turmoil, guilt, fury, and love. A gorgeous, memorable story that deserves a place both on school and public library shelves. That was from the School Library Journal. Next up is Beth Reekles. I feel like she doesn't need that much of an introduction. She's known for a small title that you might have heard of called The Kissing Booth. The first two books have been adapted into Netflix films, with the third in the works, and has been touted by Forbes, the most viewed Netflix films to date. Currently, Beth has been working on somewhat of a departure. Her new novel, Lockdown on London Lane, a story that involves a cast of characters forced to quarantine in a multiplex due to a pandemic. And finally, we have Natalie Walton, author of the upcoming novel, Revenge of the Sluts, due out in bookstores February 2nd, 2021, a title we are already getting great response about. Words like ambitious and introspective are just the tip of the encouragement and excitement surrounding Natalie's bold debut novel. It takes on relationships, privacy, and the sexualization of bodies in the digital age. See, I wasn't kidding. This is an impressive panel. And I get the privilege to get to have a wonderful conversation with them all. Okay, let's dive in. The world was, is, and will continue for years to come to be overwhelmed with the impact of COVID-19. And in an interesting turn of events, with many of us being kept at our homes and spending more and more time online and engaging with social media, the divisiveness between gender, class, sexual orientation, race, and their various intersections was at the forefront. Though these are far from new issues, certain moments really triggered a global outcry. After the tragedies of Breonna Taylor in March, then George Floyd soon after in May, and of course the shooting of Jacob Blake that left him paralyzed in August, the Black Lives Matter movement seemed to be stronger and more emboldened than ever. For much of this year, people around the world have taken to the streets to protest anti-Black racism, police brutality, and the systems that have oppressed Black communities for hundreds of years. As history has shown us, for Black people, the ability to write and read at times has been our own act of defiance. So it's no surprise that even today, marginalized people often turn to the written word in times of crisis. At Wattpad, we definitely saw this reflected on our platform. According to our data, stories by Black authors on Wattpad saw a surge in support around the same time as these global protests against racism and police brutality were taking place. Our data shows that users spent more than 18 million minutes reading stories tagged Black Lives Matter and 45 million minutes reading stories tagged Celebrate Black Writers in 2020. Interestingly enough, maybe interesting isn't the word, but Daven, your novel, The Invincible Summer of Juniper Jones, that deals with issues of racism and Black identity in the 1950s during the Jim Crow era, was released at the height of this racial unrest that was happening all over the world. So I've got to ask, how did you feel to have a book based in fiction and in history be so ever present in 2020? I'm just starting light. It's fine.
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely weird. Like, I obviously did not predict the situation that my book was going to be released into. In fact, like, it was delayed by a month from the initial release date because of the pandemic. And on one hand, you know, because of the global consciousness around Black Lives Matter and the push toward allyship for non-Black people, I do think that my book benefited from that, in that a lot of people were seeking to read more books by Black authors, as you mentioned, Diana, and I think a lot of people found that my book gave them something to learn a little bit about what it means to be an ally, and like how to navigate these relationships. At the same time, it's like I'm happy my book's done well, but I'm not happy that it did well in the context that it was released into. I think it's ultimately like, yeah, I'm really glad that people are picking it up and that it's resonating with people. And also, like, I didn't write the book to be a like how to be an ally guide. I didn't write it to be this thing to teach people. I wrote it to be a story that I hoped a lot of people would resonate with. I'm glad they are resonating with it. And also I wish it was under different circumstances.
Those are great points. Yeah. I think it's tough. It's a tough position to be in, to on some level feel like, am I benefiting from the thing that has kept people that look just like me oppressed? Or is this an opportunity to further the conversation, to have people reflect on their own identities, their own allyship, and their place in this conversation. But yeah, I mean, I was working with you at the time, so it was definitely a tough, a weird space to be in for sure. And you did touch a little bit on advocacy and allyship. And one of the other noticeable highlights on the Wattpad platform was that there was an increase in stories tagged activism and stories that touched on political themes. They increased by 93% when we compared to 2019. And I think the both questions about insight, questions and insights around surrounding advocacy and allyship have been a hot button issue because of the very public calling out of some people, and oftentimes celebrities mostly, for their performative activism and allyship. Daven, in your book, the main characters, Ethan and Juniper, are dealing with what many of us have had to face this year, which is difficulty navigating what is what I'm quoting as interracial friendships, although I didn't, that's not mine. I stole it from Emmy Natuso and Anne Freedom, who wrote it in their book, Big Friendship. But I thought that was an interesting way to phrase that. Because allyship, what does that even look like between friends? And Juniper specifically doesn't always know how or how often to stand up for her friend Ethan. How difficult was it for you to develop that particular friendship? And do you think that storytelling is a useful vehicle for advocacy and political engagement?
Yeah, so starting with that first question, honestly, it wasn't hard to write Juniper as someone who tries to be an ally but makes mistakes, because it's honestly like something that I've seen reflected in my friendships oftentimes with non-Black people, and especially with white people, that, you know, there's a sense of really trying and really wanting to be an ally, but I think the word has often like become so watered down, like we don't even know what it really means anymore. And so writing Juniper as someone who's constantly making like these mistakes was, it just like made sense to me, because that, like, I wouldn't expect her to be perfect, and I think it would be like a misrepresentation of how people actually are if she was perfect all the time. And then for thinking about storytelling as an avenue for advocacy, I think that's totally a role it can play. I think that storytelling, and a lot of times, is an act of resistance and a radical act. And I mean, thinking about how not just written stories, but how stories have been passed orally and through art over years and through generations, and especially among marginalized people who otherwise like didn't have access to you know, writing or books or et cetera. And I think that in and of itself makes storytelling really powerful. And I think the way we're seeing more and more marginalized creators and artists sharing their stories, whether fictional or autobiographical, I think that's like a very interesting and important shift towards books and stories that reflect what life is really like.
Yeah, that's a really good point. That was great. Do you find that after all that has happened, that it might have some impact in what you write moving forward?
That's an interesting question.
I say this to a person who, as a teenager, came up with the idea of The Invincible Summer of Juniper Jones, just a historical fiction about race relations in the Jim Crow era. You know, many years later, a lot of these themes are coming up again. And so I wonder if you've had that moment where you're like, wow, this is, I'm in the right direction. This is the space that I want to be in. Or is there an opportunity for me to kind of do something different or tell a different story or galvanize a different community?
Yeah, so I would say when I wrote, or when I first came up with Invincible Summer and first started writing it, I was 17 and I was like, it was kind of a phase of me like processing a lot of like racial trauma that had happened in high school and middle school, and sort of my own understanding of my identity as a biracial person. And so in that way, you know, I think this book, I hope that it resonates with other Black kids, with other kids of color. At the same time, I do think that because I did write it as sort of like a way to process, I wasn't necessarily thinking like this, like I want to tell a story that is like a Black story and like in a Black setting. And so I think like moving forward, you know, I'm really proud of Invincible Summer. I think that like the things that Ethan struggles with are things that a lot of Black and biracial kids struggle with. But I think going forward, I want to sort of move away from writing within this like white gaze of like, you know, he's in this white town, and I want to start moving towards stories that center full casts of color. And I do think that coming out of, like that has developed coming out of this experience, and realizing that I want to write things that are like in the communities I occupy.
That's great, that's interesting. Yeah, that totally makes sense. And I want to open up to the other ladies as well for the stuff that has happened that we're talking about now with regard to Black Lives Matter, or, you know, a lot of the discussions happening. Do you feel like in this day and age, with everything going on, with all the things that everyone's discussing kind of publicly, and I'm sure on many occasions privately as well, do you feel like it has changed how you think you want to write moving forward? Or your take on telling stories is kind of the continuing what you want to continue to do? Beth, I'll let you jump in first, and then Natalie, if you have anything.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's something that, you know, like as a white person, I obviously tried to sit back and take a lot in and have those conversations with people that I knew, and just kind of learn stuff, which, you know, looking for more Black and people of colour creators, things like that. And then thinking how do I need to kind of apply this to some of my own work and make the best use of this platform that I do have that's going to kind of help make that positive change, which I've not actually tried to vocalise before. So I hope
No, it's great.
I hope that was coherent.
That was, I promise it was. No, that you made, that's a really good point. I think for you especially, there is a huge platform that you have now with a lot of the attention that your works are getting. And I'm sure that it'll seep past this year and years to come. So it's a really good point that, you know, there is a some level of responsibility that the stories that you're sharing are no longer just yours, and there's a responsibility to be inclusive in the content that you're writing. Natalie, do you share a similar sentiment?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think one of the key things too that I've really learned and tried to kind of get better with is understanding my place, I guess, is kind of understanding what stories are mine to tell and how far, and kind of what voices should be featured and what stories are, you know, how they should be focused on in my books, what I should be contributing, what conversations are even mine to be had, if that makes sense. I don't know if I'm articulating that particularly well, but I think that was kind of the key thing that I've been trying to get better with, is understanding kind of what I can say and what I should say, and when I should instead just be elevating the voices of the people who are actually living through these experiences.
That's a really great point. And I think that is kind of an important point to make, that you're not always going to know the exact right thing to do. And I think that as humans, we're always learning and we're always growing, at least that's the hope. And so even if you stumble once in an attempt to do something well, that you can learn from that, accept the questions and maybe insights from other people around you, and you can just continue to move forward. And the storytellers, I think that you, all three of you, do a really great job at that. So yeah, I think, yeah, that was great. Again, like I said, this panel, I can't even, you guys are just so eloquent, so smart, so creative. I absolutely love it. And let's move on a little bit and change directions. Because with Black Lives Matter, it wasn't the only social movement that found support through storytelling this year. Just as traditional media and social media were debating about the appropriateness of young women dancing, singing, and what we are wearing, there was an influx of stories about body positivity, neurodiversity, and self-esteem on Wattpad as well in 2020. It is evident that this is the conversation that's happening globally, are often reflected back in stories. For Natalie, your story, Revenge of the Sluts, is a perfect example of this. You explore issues of consent, feminism, and slut shaming, to name a few. With a crop of new teen and young adult influencers, many of them young women, they're finding their voice and their identity and doing it all for the world to see and judge mercilessly. I personally can see the importance of a work like yours, but I'd like to hear from you, obviously without giving too much of the plot away, because it's out in February. Why was it important for you to write a story like this?
Yeah, I ended up kind of going back to like where the book even came from. I kind of wrote it from a place of, I guess, like anger. Like I always feel kind of weird calling it anger, I think, because at the time I don't know if that was the word necessarily. I think it was kind of a feeling of like kind of fear and confusion and just kind of this overwhelming sensation of like, oh, like I'm okay, I feel like I'm an adult now and I have to deal with these really adult things that feel way too big for me as like a, you know, 11, 12, 13 year old girl. And I think I really wanted to give voice to that growing up and kind of figuring out how exactly to write Revenge of the Sluts and how to communicate those feelings that I had when I was growing up and kind of how I feel now and just kind of trying to push it all together into one book and talk about, you know, revenge porn, which is something that I saw in my own high school and my own middle school going back. So it's things where, I mean, these are very real circumstances and things that I wanted to touch on in my books. I don't know if that really answered the question.
I mean, essentially what you're saying is that it came from a very impassioned feeling that you wanted to tell these stories, partly from personal experience, but also larger than that as well. And I think that that 100% makes sense.
Yeah, I jokingly call the book my magnum opus at this point, just because it sums up so much of like my growing up process and kind of everything that there is to me, all of the feelings and the anger and the kind of just like what it was like growing up and feeling so like grossly aware and kind of on display almost. Like it was this feeling of like, what is going on? And like having, you know, Instagram kind of start to hit its peak when I was growing up. I mean, I remember making an Instagram account at the very early stages of it and kind of growing up with that and trying to learn like, you know, or Snapchat was a huge thing. It's like how exactly to navigate these new fields where there was no regulation. Like nobody was telling us what we really should or shouldn't do in these circumstances. So it was kind of like the, you know, the Wild West when we were growing up. And it was trying to kind of figure out like where we fit into that and what we were allowed to do with our bodies, what people are going to comment on, kind of learning how to take, I guess like, I don't want to call it feedback because it's not necessarily always feedback, but just like comments from people and like all of these, you know, online, all this discourse about bodies and our selfies and things like that. I feel like I'm talking in circles, but that's kind of the general idea. It was just I wanted to try and communicate that, I guess.
But I think that you make a very good point. I mean, not to age myself, but in my, I don't know how I would handle social media or, you know, positioning myself on a Snapchat or Instagram at such a formative age. I mean, the worst that we had was three-way calling, and that felt so toxic for that. So I can't imagine that times 100. And I mean, you jokingly said, I feel like I'm talking in circles, but social media kind of is like a conversation that's happening in circles. You post something with the intention of one thing. How people receive it can be what you think or what you don't think, but everyone is ready to tell you. So then you try to like post something else. It's like that whole existence is cyclical. So it's okay if it sounds like you're talking in circles, because the experience is cyclical. Okay, yeah. So let's go even deeper, because we know that words that we choose to describe ourselves can have an impact on how others perceive us, speaking of social media, whether we like it or not, right? What your intention isn't always how it's received. But I think what you do a great job of in this book is the reclaiming of a derogatory word or a name. That isn't a new concept, but it definitely continues to be a bold and impactful decision nonetheless. For you, not only the word slut is emblazoned on the cover as part of the title, but the main characters in your book band together to recreate the slut squad. Was it important for you to use that word slut throughout the book? And did you feel like it was a feeling of empowerment or defiance, or even better yet, a combination of the two? So tell us a little bit about your decision for that.
Yeah, it's funny because I've reached the point, almost threw my pen, I reached the point where I don't even really think about the title anymore. Like, I'm just kind of like, oh yeah, like the word slut, like, of course, like, it just doesn't really like register, I think. And I was trying to come up with an answer to this question, just like thinking about it. I'm like, I don't know necessarily when I became like comfortable enough with the word to say, yeah, I want this to be in a title for a book, and I want it to be a huge part of a book. I mean, it feels like, you know, I was like 12 or 13 and I was like, yeah, of course. Like, I would make that the title. Like, it's, you know, it's playful. Like, the word is like, it's serious and it means something, but it's also just something people say to each other as this kind of like, you know, almost a sense of, it's a term of endearment to some people, in the same way, you know, I can't say profanity, but like calling each other like the B word is, or something like that. It's, you know, there's all of these different words, or I'm seeing something now where it's, you know, reclaiming the word bimbo, or I have friends online in the LGBTQ community who are taking back what would be considered slurs, and they're featuring them in, you know, their bios and their Twitter usernames. Like, they're just like casually using those words to refer to themselves, just to, you know, and I don't want to speak to anybody's personal reasons for why they might reclaim it, but I know for me personally, using something like the word slut is kind of this feeling of like, I think defiance is probably the best way. It's kind of like, yeah, maybe I am, like, you know, kind of just being able to say that straight up and being able to have those conversations and maybe even ask ourselves, you know, why calling somebody a slut is such a bad thing? Why are we so afraid of the idea of female sexuality and sluttiness, basically?
That's a great explanation, for sure. I love that. So let's continue this conversation. I wasn't kidding. We are going there. and I think that's interesting in all these conversations that, you know, we're starting with a story like Juniper, and then now with Revenge of the Sluts, you ladies were not afraid to just go there with those conversations in your book. And now when we move to kind of another part of what the whole world was talking about, which is COVID, I think among the various issues, COVID-19, kind of the pandemic, really centered the world. It really had us all consumed and concerned with uncertainty. This unprecedented event has connected every corner of the globe. In a time where reality feels scarier than fiction, you might assume that people may want to avoid some dystopian and pandemic narratives. But as our data suggests, for some people, the opposite was true. Users spent more than 16 million minutes reading stories tagged COVID-19 in 2020, and stories tagged pandemic increased by 2,104% over 2019. So where Daven and Natalie felt to go right for the jugular, like I mentioned earlier, Beth is working on a new piece, Lockdown in London Lane, and it follows the characters who are in the midst of a pandemic. And it seems like for Beth, your approach was to add levity to an otherwise stressful and uncertain situation. So I'd like you to give us a little bit about your inspiration for tackling this subject this way, and how you felt kind of taking this approach.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the kind of person that any sort of topic that feels troublesome or heavy to me personally, I have a very sort of self-deprecating, sarcastic attitude. So that tends to be my way of coping with things for me. And I was actually really concerned when I started writing the book and uploading it on Wattpad that people were going to think I was just making light of this whole pandemic situation. And I remember kind of agonizing over the way I wrote the introduction, just to say, I'm not trying to do that. I just, you know, this is my coping mechanism. Maybe it's some of yours as well. You know, because I just remember towards the start, you know, I live by myself. So I've been alone for pretty much 9 months of the year. And I'm an extrovert, so I kind of really look for that sense of connection and community. Mm-hmm. And towards the start of the year, I really loved reading blogs, tweets, seeing Instagram stories of people, seeing how they were coping and, you know, what they were getting up to, whether it was just like the 20th person who baked banana bread that day or you know, something a little bit heavier. And I just remember thinking, like, I would really like to read a book about this.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that's the kind of content I'm consuming at the minute. It's the sort of thing I want to read about, something that's, you know, not all doom and gloom, like every news alert that I was getting on my phone with the rising number of cases and everything. Just something that was like normal, or at least the new normal, as we all found it. And kind of just like that, I had my cast of characters and I thought, oh, well, I guess I could write this book. And, you know, I thought, well, put it on Wattpad. Like I said, maybe other people will find this a good coping mechanism as well. And it seemed like they did.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I obviously haven't read the full thing, but I know enough about it that I'm like, you know, and there are definitely moments for sure where, a few of my girlfriends and I were like, well, we're alone. Maybe we can find a foreign love affair over Zoom, or, you know what I mean? Or any of these dating apps. So that definitely people were talking about things too. And in darkness, sometimes there is light and you take it where you can get it. So I think that totally makes sense that that's kind of where you decided to put your energy. And I mean, moving to the next point, the pandemic made it so that social activity and in-person interactions were limited and online engagement increased. In various ways, many of us are usually able to manage our health and wellness, but that was no longer at our disposal. And people were not afraid to share their personal struggles online. Mental health has been a major topic of discussion for 2020. This too was reflected in our user patterns on Wattpad. The number of stories tagged mental health increased by 32% compared to 2019. And users spent 240 million minutes reading stories with this tag. That is a lot of time. People also spent more than 200 million minutes reading stories tagged anxiety in 2020, which was up 59% from last year. For Beth, again, would you say that writing a story about the pandemic was helpful to manage your own feelings and fears about it? And did it serve as a source of solace or comfort in an uncertain time? I think it's often that with fiction, there is an opportunity to create and consume narratives of hopefulness during a difficult time, obviously thoughtfully, of course, and you clearly write from a place of levity and hopefulness. So that's where you write from. But in terms of what you're consuming in terms of content, is that kind of the direction that you go in, whether it's television, film, books, or other opportunities for media?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely tend towards that side of levity and hopefulness. And you know, everything I consume, I could barely sort of sit through 10 minutes of the news without feeling really, you know, just overwhelmed and depressed. And kind of working on Lockdown on London Lane was just, that's the topic of this whole thing. It was just really cathartic for me.
Yeah.
Kind of helped me work through some of the weirdness and the uncertainty and, you know, being kind of scared of the whole thing. Like I said, I was completely on my own for most of the year. You know, I wasn't going into the office. I wasn't really seeing friends or family or anything like that. So, you know, it kind of allowed me to have that, you know, get back into that sense of community online on Wattpad, as well as other social media as well. So I think though that the topic of kind of levity and hopefulness, we do obviously need to kind of sometimes get into the meat of things, or, you know, go for the jugular, as you kind of said earlier, because it is really important and we do need those views. But sometimes, like, you know, for me personally, it's just sometimes that I need a bit of light relief or a bit of comic relief or something like that, just because that's my way of working through things sometimes. And like I said, I was hoping it was going to be the case for at least some other people out there as well, you know, and that, I guess that was my way of offering a little bit of community and help to them as well.
Yeah, and you brought up a good point as well. Like, not only were you kind of creating your own narratives around a global pandemic and taking an approach that was a little bit more light and levity, which is great and is often needed, but you also said that because writing on Wattpad in particular, there was a community that was created even in the writing process. So for someone like yourself who spent most of this quarantine alone, that's a lot of time to be spent all by yourself, especially for somebody who is a bit more social. And did you feel like that was kind of integral to find a community, whether it was online through your writing or in other spaces?
Yeah, definitely. And I know, because I've struggled with my mental health, like depression and anxiety, quite a lot in the past. So I know things that keep me, I guess, sane and happy day to day. And one of those things is, you know, that sense of connection with people that I get usually from hanging out with friends. But in this case, it was, you know, reading all the comments on Wattpad, or, you know, they were like debates about how people take their tea. And I was like, I'm loving this. And, you know, like dozens of people engaging about how they make tea. And I was like, this is excellent. Oh my God, I'm living for this today.
You're like, this debate is exactly what I needed in this very moment.
Yeah, exactly.
And I guess I'll open up to the other ladies as well in terms of, you know, what you're consuming as we get close to the end of this year. Do you find that you're leaning towards stuff that adds a bit more levity, kind of just goes there with the discussion, or are you finding a little bit of a balance, like some days levity, some days not? I guess Daven, we'll start with you.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's really been a mix. I don't think there's any pattern to the type of media I've been consuming this year. Early on in quarantine, I was watching a lot of cartoons. But then, like, just a couple days ago, I watched all of The Undoing in one sitting. And, like, the books I've been reading have been, like, a real mix between, like, contemporary YA, and like a lot of queer stories. And then on the other hand, reading a lot of like Black feminist theory and like critical race theory. So it's like kind of just whenever I finish a book, I look at my bookshelf and I just like see what calls me based on like the spine of it and just go with that. So.
I love that. Natalie, what about you?
Yeah, I was gonna say about the same. I really don't think I have any sort of like patterns for anything. Like I've tried to kind of mix it up, and I'll have days where I'm like, I think I need like a comfort movie. But other times I don't know what it like, I tend to be pretty like shy. Like I don't communicate well, but like I tend to like the feeling of like getting angry, like getting like worked up about something and being able to just like vent about it, which is such a weird thing to confess and like but like it's, I don't know, I kind of like that feeling of like working through something and like having that drive to almost like talk something through. And I mean, it's been like, you know, I'm good friends with Daven and we have a group chat where occasionally we'll like, you know, just start, you know, talking about something. Like it's just somebody will bring something up and we just talk through the whole thing, and I find that so much more cathartic and pleasing, and just like I feel better after doing something like that than like watching something light and easy. So it's kind of just been finding almost what works for me, like what is almost a form of like, you know, I don't want to call it self-care because that doesn't seem like self-care to get like intentionally worked up about something, but like it's like a form of just like expressing myself and remembering that it's okay to get upset about something and it's okay to feel really overwhelmed by the state of the world and what's going on. But otherwise I read pretty much exclusively like YA contemporary, like generally pretty light and pretty easy. But that's just like a consistency. That's usually my kind of like grounding force, is I'll read something like, you know, you should see me in a crown and I'll like, you know, smile through the whole thing, that kind of idea.
I love that. I mean, so you guys have depth and have layers, obviously. there's not one way. And you can call whatever you want as self-care. That's perfectly fine. I mean, listen, I could go on and on, but there are questions that are already coming in literally as we started. So let's start getting into the audience questions. So let's just start here. I know they're coming in so quickly. Okay, so from Elena, she wants to know from all the panelists, where did you find inspiration for writing these amazing books? I like to go alphabetically, so let's do Beth, Daven, and then Natalie.
I tend to get most of my book ideas. I'll finish working on one, so I've not long finished editing like a summer holiday book just before I started lockdown on London Lane. And then I was in the shower listening to a song and I thought, oh, that would be a really great idea for a book. And then like, bang, the cast were in my head. And that same evening, I just kind of started trying to work out, you know, because there's five different sort of main characters in their story. So I was trying to kind of muddle them through in my head before I started writing. And then I just kind of got stuck in, and it wasn't a particularly complex or complicated process. I just kind of thought, yeah, this could work. That could be good fun. Let's just run with it and see.
Fair enough. Daven, go ahead.
I mean, so I came up with the idea for Invincible Summer back in 2014. And it came out of like wanting to write a story, like a summer story. I've talked about this before, but I imagine the lake in Invincible Summer as being the lake in Camp Rock. And like, that's just like an image I have in my head. And I'd wanted to write about like the Camp Rock lake for like a long time. But like really also I up to that point had mostly written stories with white characters because I thought that that's what people wanted to read. And so with Invincible Summer, I really wanted to actually like write characters who looked like me and write stories that felt like they actually resonated with me and like and my friends and what I'd experienced growing up. And yeah, I mean, from there, I think like coming back to edit it in 2019 was a lot of exploring sort of what we talked about with like these interracial friendships and allyship and yeah, just what it means to step into your identity as a Black person and all the things it can look like.
Oh, that starts with something small and then you were like, but I also want to say all these other things in the story. It's great. Natalie, what about you?
Yeah, mine came from like a whole bunch of different pieces, like Revenge of the Sluts in terms of like actually planning it. I came up with the idea when I was watching ECA for the first time. It's like I was in like middle school whenever it came out. and like, I remember watching it and being like, okay, this is like interesting. Cause I think that was the first time anybody had actually attempted to define like everything that I'd been seeing around me. Like nobody had ever sat me down and said like, hey, this is what slut shaming is, you know, that kind of idea, but like I would still see it. And I think that was kind of the driving force behind the whole book, but I didn't have the vocabulary, didn't have the experiences when I was, you know, 13 to be able to actually write the book. So I just kept it on the back burner. And then I wanted to write a mystery. So I spent like 3 years attempting to write a mystery to no avail. And then I wanted to write a book about journalism, which like I couldn't figure out how to make it work. And then I was like, what if I just put them all together? So that's kind of what happened, was I had three separate book ideas and I was like, oh, like this is a cohesive plot. So that was the whole process for me. Yeah.
love that. I love the journey you went on to getting where you ended up. Like, I do love that journey for you, for sure. Okay, so our next question. This might be a controversial one. If you could go back and change your books in any way, shape, or form, would you? This is coming from Kara.
So for me, I guess, no, but only insofar as that's kind of a snapshot of that moment in time for me, kind of as a reader, as a writer, as a person. And obviously, like, you know, looking back on stories that I wrote when I was, you know, 13, 15, 17, you know, even last year, yeah, I will have learned things and kind of changed as a person since then. But I kind of like that, and, you know, like reflecting back on those stories and thinking, oh, but I'm not necessarily like the same person I am now as when I wrote that.
Right.
And that's okay with me. So I don't know if that's a controversial answer. But
I don't think it is. Not at all.
Yeah, I mean, there are things like I haven't like sat down and like reread my book in full, and like might not ever, but I'm sure there are things that I'd want to change, like just like little moments and interactions between characters. But on the whole, I'd agree with Beth. And like, yeah, I do like to see the way that my stories sort of exist as this like representation of who I was at that time. I think the only thing I would change, because all my family made fun of me for this, is that Ethan has a cousin named what's his name? It's either Harry or Henry. And there were a couple times where I put the other name in the book, and like without fail, like all my aunts were like, did you see where you did this? So that's the only thing I would change.
Okay.
So my answer might actually be the controversial one. I love rewriting my stuff. Like I love being able to sit back and be like, okay, so this was terrible. Like, how can we make this more of something? And I really like the final product of Revenge of the Sluts. And I think it captures a lot of what I was trying to do, but it's like, you know, if I could have written like 500 pages and have explored, you know, like maybe Sloane's point of view, or if I could have like kind of amped up Eden's growth as a person, I would have loved to have had the opportunity to kind of explore that more. Like, I like the final product, but it's definitely one of those where I'm like, if somebody was like, hey, could you, you know, come up with like a new version of it? I'd be like, yeah, I probably could. Like, it's, I don't know. I view stories as kind of like a constantly moving thing. Kind of what Beth and Daven have been saying is like, you know, stories are a moment in time, and for me, I'm kind of like, you know, throw it out, like I'm past that at a certain point, which is like which has made first drafts really interesting for me, because I usually end up changing roughly 75% of the new draft. Sure. So it's a nightmare, and I I would not recommend writing like this, but it works for me.
I mean, all fair answers, I think, but it's funny because I always find that with creatives, they're definitely like, no, like this is a definitely like what Beth and Dom were saying. It's a moment in time. It's a piece of who I was. Natalie's like, no, we're done with her. We've moved on to somebody else now, which is great. I mean, speaking of, I think Daven had mentioned her family kind of calling out little things that might have been a misstep in her works. What do your families think about the books and the messages that you've told?
Well, my family's a little bit mixed. So, some of them have read the book, some of them haven't. I remember one of the first radio interviews I did, my dad was only going to like drive me there. But they kind of dragged him into the studio, sat him down, and then live on air, they say, so Dad, have you read The Kissing Booth? And he was like, no, I don't think I'm the target audience. And, you know, they didn't know what to say. And I thought, well, yeah, he's not going to read it. Like, he's not going to enjoy it at all. In terms of, like, the messages, I mean, I hate the idea of anyone that I know in real life reading my books. I don't know why, but that was part of the reason I really loved Wattpad in the first place, was the anonymity of it. And that kind of freedom. but for, I mean, they've never been that horrible about it, so I hope they're okay with whatever messages are in my books, whatever messages they take from them at any rate.
Fair enough. I mean, I feel like if they didn't, they'd tell you.
Yes, my mum and my sister definitely would.
Daven?
I mean, apart from just pointing out every typo or thing that could be a typo that they see, my dad, like, he was like, I'm making notes for you as I read Invincible Summer of things that I see. but they're very, very supportive. I mean, both of my parents read the book and really liked it and like had specific things that they liked about it. My grandmother notably was like really excited about it, and she read it in like 2 days, and then my parents hadn't finished it yet, and so she called them and she was like, if you don't finish it soon, I'm gonna tell you the ending. And so so that was very sweet.
Natalie, what about, I'm almost like nervous to hear what your family has to say. I don't know why.
Yeah, no, I think that's valid, because I honestly didn't tell my parents what I was working on until I got my contract, and I was kind of like, hey, I don't think I'm old enough to like do this, so can I wrote a book, I have a deal, can you help me? And I will say, I do not come from necessarily a family of readers. My mom is very much a reader, but I think she's nervous to pick it up. Like, I think it's kind of one of those, like, what is this book actually about? Like, what's going to be, she doesn't know what she's going to get into. So I have actually no idea if she is planning on reading it. We're very kind of like, I guess I should say, I'm a very private person, kind of what Beth was saying about like the idea of like having people read my stuff that I know personally is really kind of like I like it, but I'm also kind of like, don't do that, because it's really scary and it's really just kind of like overwhelming. So I'm not really like, you know, I don't know, I wouldn't necessarily wait for them to have feedback for me, but they've been very supportive through the whole process. They, you know, proudly share the book on like Facebook and stuff like that. And, you know, they take all of the comments from their friends that are like, wow, what a title. So they kind of field all of that for me. But yeah, I mean, it's, I don't think I'll be getting any direct feedback, but I think they're proud. I think they almost understand what the purpose and plot of the book is.
Well, that's good. I mean, at least now they know these things exist for you, Beth, and you, Natalie. I mean, and you talked about you both, Beth and Natalie in particular, about how you're a lot more private. So now that it's, I mean, Natalie, you're almost there. Beth, you're definitely there, but it's out there. It's public. You are now a published author, and this is great. How has this career and life changed you? And do you have any tips for other aspiring authors? This is for all of you.
I keep assuming that we're going to keep going in alphabetical order, but if,
yeah, that's fine.
And Natalie, kind of want to jump in first, feel free. But I mean, in terms of that career and how it's changed me, I got my first book deal when I was 17, a week after I'd sent off my university applications to go and do a physics degree. So I kind of carried on with that sort of physics and tech path, and I have a day job working in IT for an energy company now, which is really glamorous. But I think sort of that being an author, it's taught me a lot of skills that I don't think I would have acquired otherwise. And it's taught me a lot about myself and, like, you know, who I am as a person, the way I like to work, what I kind of value and what I want from my life and my career. So I actually like left the first job I had out of uni because I learned a lot from kind of being an author that fed into that. And in terms of advice, I mean, I always recommend sharing your book online because it's such a huge motivator. It's such a big confidence boost. And again, it just teaches you a lot about yourself in a way that's just really invaluable, and that I don't think you can kind of get anywhere else. It's a really unique sort of experience.
Yeah, that's a great point. Like the learnings that happen in all the iterations of, you know, creating your story and having people look at it and judge it, and like it looks a little bit different than when you started. And yeah, I think that that's a good learning, a learning tool for sure. Daven, what about you?
I mean, so definitely a lot has changed in the sense that like more people know who I am now, and like I've written something that's now like exists in the public for consumption. But I think because like I've just always been writing, like it doesn't feel like anything has like super significantly changed. Like, I don't know, I still go and write my first drafts and hate them and tell all my friends how bad they are and like workshop them and whatever. And like, it's like that meme that's like, every day I like put on my silly little clothes and do my silly little tasks. I still do my silly little tasks every day. But now I have a book published and that's really exciting. And as for advice, I think like one of the best things that I got from Wattpad and one of the best things I have now as a writer is my community of fellow writers. Like Nat mentioned, we're close friends and we have a group of friends who all like during NaNoWriMo, we all would like write together and do word sprints and just like suffer together through writing and complain about writing and like why did we choose to do this. But I think like building a community is so important, whether it's people you know in real life, people you meet on sites like Wattpad. That's a really great way to stay motivated.
Amazing. And as we close out the hour, oh, I'm saying that we can go past time. I love having freedom. Natalie, let's let you answer that question. And then I can thank everyone for coming and any other questions. And then we'll give all of your information for anyone that wants to kind of reach out to you guys directly. But I do want to hear from you, Natalie, especially, you know, as the new one to the group. We have Beth, who's like definitely far at the other end where it's not just a book, but it's not one, not two, but almost three movies. And Daven, who just came out this summer, and Natalie, you're up next. So maybe you have, you're more closely tied to this experience, and like the sometimes trauma of editing is very still close to your arms. So how do you feel about your career now as a writer, and what tips would you give an aspiring writer?
Yeah, I honestly, I feel like I am a writer now. Like, I think that's the best way that I can sum it up is like, you know, I've been writing for basically, you know, my entire life kind of on and off, and I've been working on projects, but it's like the first time I really felt like a writer is when I actually got like editing notes and I was working and actually like had a project to do. I do think it has a little bit of like a I feel like I still haven't fully processed that it's all happening, even though I've received like physical arcs of the book, but I feel like I still have this like, I don't know, like especially with everything that's been going on, like I'm back at my parents' house, I graduated directly into a pandemic, like I there's all sorts of other things right now where I'm kind of like, okay, let's like, we'll do that first, like it's exciting that I have a book and like I get to celebrate like little things when they come up, but it's kind of like, you know, for now, I'm like, okay, one day at a time, like, we'll figure it out. We'll see what happens. But I do think kind of on like a positive note, I have been so inspired to write since getting the book done. When I was originally working on Revenge of the Sluts, I remember saying, you know, like, I think this is going to be my only one. Like, like, I really was just like, I don't have the inspiration. I don't have the motivation. Like, I just don't know how I could follow up on this. But I mean, I ended up writing like basically two full manuscripts over 2020. I mean, like they're not great. Frankly, they're really bad, but like, that's like, I was writing. And I think that was a really big step for me. It was actually sitting down and like writing and really believing in myself and thinking about, you know, the future and kind of trying to figure out how to navigate things like, you know, going to grad school and also wanting to be an author and that kind of idea. So I've definitely taken it more seriously, I think. And then for advice, I honestly like, my favorite advice is it's okay to sit on stuff. Like you don't have to write that book in that moment. Like you should consistently be writing or at least trying to, but like for me, all of my ideas take some time to kind of like get there. Like I have to like kind of ruminate over them and kind of let it just like sit for a little bit. So it's okay if it doesn't stick and you can't figure out why you can't write a mystery. Like it took me like, you know, basically, you know, 4 or 5 years to actually figure out a plot for a mystery and then another 2 to get it published. So it's kind of like, you know, it's a process. It's okay. You don't have to figure it out right now at this very second.
And if anything, we're in a pandemic. Don't try to accomplish everything right now. Like a process, if there was any kind of takeaway, it's that like, take your time, do like have that balance and definitely find yourself a community if you can. Obviously on Wattpad is a great place if you are a new or a expert writer. It's a great place to find community and to get some insights and some feedback as well. Listen, I would love to talk for 2 more hours and continue this conversation, but where Natalie left it off is such a good spot to close out the day. I cannot thank you, incredible panelists, enough. You were bold, you were bright, you were eloquent, beautiful, like all the things. So thank you so much for giving us the time today and sharing your stories and your experiences and everything. All of your questions, all the questions that you answered were fantastic. And I'm so glad to have had the chance to reflect on, I don't even know if roller coaster is the right word to say for this year. We're at the end of it. You guys have done amazing and thank you so, so, so much. And I think you really have changed how people are reading and writing. And I personally couldn't be more thankful. So to read Wattpad's full 2020 year in review, we're going to share a link in the chat. This is Wattpad Speaks. If you do want to drop any additional questions or comments, hashtag Wattpad Speaks on our Insta and Twitter. And the details of where you can reach these ladies will also be available about their socials. Thank you everyone for joining us. I think we had just over 50 people at some point in Canada. It is the middle of the day. So I couldn't appreciate you guys more. Again, thank you to the panelists. Thank you to the audience. Thank you for the marketing team at Wattpad that helped put this together. And everyone, have yourself an amazing rest of your day, or for Beth, evening, because it is late over there in the UK. So thank you for joining us. Thank you, everybody. And yeah, have yourself a great day. Thank you.